here on Radio UNT. Hear me now.
I'm missing right choice philosophy. Cut out them last of it. We gon' limitate my frequency. You can't keep track of it. Lyrical audacity, creating animosity. Life is built in property with proper terminology. Oh!
Welcome to the Writing Devil Show, where we preach the word, teach the word, listen to some tunes, and start a revolution.
My God!
All right, guys, welcome to the Righteous Rebel Show. I'm so grateful to have you guys on today. Today, we actually have a very interesting topic. It's going to be great. How God has been good. He's been depositing and just giving me things that just really are going to help build us, going to make us stronger, and help us going to fight these battles in a greater way for his glory. So let's start off. We're going to pray, and I'll introduce the topic of what we're going to get into today. All right, so here we go. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God, for this day, Lord. We thank you for your goodness, for your grace, Father. And Lord, we just ask that you would be with us this day, God, as we look to just continually give you glory, Father God, and learn how to just overcome all the plans and all the schemes of the enemy, Lord God. We're grateful for you, and we're just grateful for another day to just be equipped, to just be full of your presence, God, to be anointed and to be utilized, God, to spread the light, God, all throughout this world, God, and take authority and take our dominion the way you would have us to do so, God, the way you have shown us, the way you have displayed, Father. So we just lift you up this day and thank you for all that you're going to do in and through our lives. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. All right. So today's topic and what we're going to jump into is actually called destroying darkness. Okay, and that's a big topic, and it's something that actually deals with, and it kind of opens up the whole world of, like, you know, the whole can of worms, basically. When you're talking about this, we're talking about coming at the enemy from all sides. We're realizing who our king is. So we're going to jump into that. And the core scripture for today's message is coming out of 1 John 4, and it's 4 through 13. So the whole context right there, and what it says is, it says, "You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. We are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us his spirit." Okay, and now that's something that sometimes we quote in church, or we hear, you know, or whatever, throughout messages and things of that nature. And we can sometimes overlook it. But when it comes to destroying darkness, right, this is such an important and crucial scripture, because it pertains to how God is the light, and the way the children of light can actually dispel darkness, and the way the children of light actually overcome darkness and are able to destroy it is by being in him and by God being in us. Okay, so that's really the focus of today's message, and it's going to help us to learn how to destroy darkness and how to overcome all the plans of the enemy. Because what tends to occur sometimes is that we give the devil too much place. We give him too much power. We give him, you know, we give him too much credence. We give him all, like, you know, we blame everything on him. But then we also assume that he's so grand, that he's so powerful, that, like, he has a sense that he can overcome us. Okay, and that can't be the case, because as children of God, as children of light, we really have all authority. We have the dominion. We have the power, because we serve the King of all kings, and he's in us and he's with us. Okay, so the first portion of what we're going to define is, what does it mean to destroy something? Okay, you know, to defeat something means to kind of have the upper hand on it and to kind of oppress it. But to actually destroy something means to put an end to its existence by damaging it or attacking it on the offensive. Okay, so when you're able to destroy something, when you have the power, you have the authority to do so, or to do something along those lines, it means you're putting an end to its existence. Okay, and that's what we're, as children of light, are called to do, right? Jesus, it says, for this reason that Jesus manifested God's glory, to destroy the works of the devil. Okay, so if we're following Christ, so much more in a magnitude or in a multitude of people are we supposed to be images and models of Christ, dispelling darkness, right? Destroying the works of the devil. If you take what Jesus did as one single individual, as God, and now you multiply it, right, to the 2 billion Christians about, you know, that all throughout the world, what are we actually doing? We're multiplying the effects of light, right? The difference, like, if you look at the night sky and you see all the stars in the sky, right? The star, the darkness cannot be completely overtaken because of the light that's there, right? So the darkness does not overcome it because the light is there. And if you look at the power of just the moon itself, it lights up the whole night sky. So if you can look at this world and look at like different cities and places that resonate light through them and in essence brighten the darkness, that's the effectiveness that we're looking for as children of light, as the church of God. We're supposed to be that beacon of light, that beacon of hope. And in regards, we're supposed to be dispelling darkness. We're supposed to be vanquishing darkness. We're supposed to be pushing back darkness in every sphere of influence. And kind of why I feel like God led me to minister on this particular topic is the fact that a lot of individuals, a lot of Christians are getting overtaken, right? It's very sad to see your brothers and sisters be overtaken by darkness, right? Whether it's in the form of backsliding or whether it's in the form of them being possessed by demons, whether it's just in the form of them not knowing their proper authority and then being oppressed or depressed and things of that nature. What we're recognizing and what I'm seeing more and more of, and it's very disheartening, is that a lot of believers don't know their spiritual authority. They don't know they might know who they belong to in a sense, but when it comes to understanding the vastness of who you are in God and who you are, where you're seated in heavenly places and how that pertains to your life and how it pertains to your success, how it pertains to your future, your destiny really needs to be comprehended, needs to be understood, and then needs to be manifested and expressed through our lives in a way that's significant enough to show that we believe we have the capacity to destroy darkness, right? It wouldn't be wise for one Christian necessarily to go against the devil by himself, but as a force, as a body, right? As the body of Christ, right? We can go against demonic forces. We can go against demons. We can come up against like a Goliath in the spirit, but know that our God is greater, right? Like greater is he that's in us and he that's in the world. And that's what we're going to focus on, okay? And then the other definition is darkness. What is darkness, right? Darkness is wickedness. It's evil. It's the absence of light or the absence of God. Okay, so when we're trying to figure out what are we actually attacking here, right? We're destroying darkness, but what is darkness, right? Darkness is the manifestation of wickedness. It's the manifestation of evil, of sin, of everything that has its origin outside of God, the absence of God, the absence of light. Okay, so when we're coming with an agenda, when we're coming on an offensive attack to destroy the works of darkness, we're destroying the works that the devil created. Right? The works of the devil, right? So if we can kind of keep that in context and realize that the purpose of us manifesting and utilizing our power and authority is to destroy the works of darkness. So more and more, what needs to be happening, even on a one-to-one basis or on like, you know, on a case-by-case situation, is that if you overcome any aspect of darkness, right? Even if you overcome sin, that means you're destroying darkness, right? If you're overcoming like evil in the world or people lying, right? And you're combating it with truth. Or if you're, you know, an activist in some form or fashion, right? Every time truth is presented, every time love is expressed, and every time the light of God is coming through or emanating from a being or a child of God, what is happening is that darkness is being destroyed. Darkness is being pushed back. Strongholds, principalities are being broken because the love of God is dispelling hate. The love of God is dispelling darkness by the light. Okay, so we need to constantly be infilled with God's love. We need to be filled with the light so that way we can actually effectively destroy darkness in the process of us, preaching the gospel and spreading the word of his kingdom. Okay, so the first portion of this is how do you grow, right? How do you develop? How do you gain the right to destroy darkness? Can you just wake up one day and be like, you know what? I just want to destroy darkness today. You know, can you actually do that and be effective, right? And just remember, like we said, you can do good works, right? You can join a charity. You can do good works. You can help poverty and things of that nature, which will still, in essence, be, you know, pushing back oppression and things that are related to darkness. But the actual essence of darkness is a source. It's a spirit, right? It's a spirit of the devil. It's a spirit of the age. It's a spiritual dynamic that we're looking to destroy. We're trying to destroy wickedness at the root. We're not trying to just destroy it for the sake of saying, okay, you know, I gave someone money today that was helpless and I increased the good in the world. No, we're trying to increase the light in the world, right? We're trying to dispel darkness at its root, the essence of it, the nature. And because we were born into sin and because sin is expressed through all different institutions and organizations all throughout this world that have been established now for a long time, ever since the beginning, the problem and the essence of why this world is so significant is because this world is owned as the kingdom is belongs to the devil, right? Because when God cast the devil out of heaven and cast him down to earth, he essentially became the God of this world. So us as insurgents, as people that are born again of the Spirit of God, we really are insurgents on a mission to spread light throughout a dark world, okay? A fallen world, a dark kind of demonic place. And we're sent in as insurgents to spread light, to bring in the kingdom of God into the kingdom of darkness, which is, you know, the devil's domain, right? So we do this, and the way we actually effectively get to do this is by learning and knowing our identity in God. Okay, that's the first portion, and it's the most significant because a lot of people try to utilize their authority, try to utilize their power, their strength, you know, quote scriptures, whatever they have to do to try to combat evil. And then what tends to occur is that when in the expression of them trying to overcome, what tends to occur more times than not is the reality that they don't really know who they are or whose they are. Right, so we try to do good in our own right. We try to say, you know, I want to bless someone today, and we just want to do things out of our own strength. But if we don't do it out of the strength of God, out of the love, out of the power, out of the knowing, our true identity as it relates to us being children of God, right? That's why we're in this particular scripture. It says we are of God, little children, right? So as children of God, what we're manifestation is the understanding that the essence, the source where we came from is God, is of light. Okay, so if we can understand and comprehend that the source of our being, the source of our existence is of light, then when it comes to contending with darkness, we don't fear it because we know the source of where which we come from, right? A lot of people get confused, or things get distorted, or they don't know how to overcome the enemy because they don't recognize that, oh, I'm actually light. So the essence of who I am in relation to who God is and me being born of him is directly connected and sourced by God himself. Okay, so when you have your identity strong and when you know who you are and whose you are, it then becomes easy to gain authority and rank as it relates to the kingdom of God, right? You can start off just knowing that you're a child of God, but then you can become like a prince, and then you can become like a king, and things of that nature, all the different fivefold ministry, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, or teacher, right? Your authority and your rank, in essence, the structure of who you are, who you become, right, through development and integrity and development and character, all become significant after you know who and whose you are as it relates to God. So remember, your identity, right, needs to be found and sourced directly in the light, in God himself. And then from there, we're just kind of like running through this basically just for the context, because we preached similar messages to this like before in spiritual warfare and being battle ready and all these different things. But I really am doing this over in a different format and setting because I'm realizing that a lot of people are still coming against opposition, coming against attacks, and not really comprehending the full authority that they actually have and how to actually gain the victory, how to actually overcome it, right? So in this regard, remember, your identity first, right? Source and connected to God. Then your authority comes in, right? Knowing the rank and the stature that you have, that you're seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus, right? This is a very significant. A believer's authority is so crucial to their dominion, right? If you let the devil push you around and you let him dictate and tell you what's going to happen in your life and you don't know how to combat it, then you're going to be so oppressed. You're going to be so depressed. Things in your life are just going to go turn sideways, right? But then beyond that, having authority, right? If you can look at authority as having like your badge and having your suit or your uniform on, you know, having the full armor of God on and the understanding, right? The helmet of salvation, things of that nature that pertain to your comprehension of identity, then it is becoming like authority is like, you know, putting on your badge, knowing who's you are, knowing that you are a soldier of God, right? Even that alone, some believers just believe I'm just a believer. I'm just a Christian. I'm just a bench warmer. I'm not a soldier. I'm not on active duty in God's army, right? That's a false perception of reality, because once you join God's kingdom, you join his army as well as you join the family. Okay, so it's very significant to recognize that you're a soldier in God's army, and soldiers get attacked, right? And soldiers know that once they shoot, they're going to be shot at. Right, or they just might be shot at just in general, whether it's the fiery darts of the enemy, however you want to put it in a biblical context. You have to understand that as a child of God, there is the realm and the possibility of being attacked spiritually and even physically in a manifestation of something that's occurring in the spirit. Okay, so all this is significant because the next aspect of this is that after you have your identity set, right, then you recognize your authority, right? And then your authority can only be typically expressed, whether you declare, decree, or make a command, right? Your authority needs to be backed up, right? And the same way Jesus did, like, you know, they used to ask him, right? The scribes and the Pharisees asked Jesus, by whose authority do you do this, right? Who gave you the power to do this? Why do you think you can just come around here and heal the sick and just do whatever you like or whatever you please or so see fit? And then what do you have to show for it, right? And then when they used to, like, condemn Jesus, they tried to say he did things of the devil, right? But then Jesus said to them, if what I'm doing, right, if I'm attacking the kingdom of darkness, right, the kingdom that I'm coming from, it would be divided against itself if I am of darkness. So Jesus was trying to indicate to them, the only reason why I'm overcoming darkness is because I'm of the children of light. I'm a child of God, right? So in these different regards, what you have to understand is the source of it, and therefore the expression of the power and the authority together makes us more whole, and the foundation is our identity and who God is, right? Knowing that he is the almighty God, he is the omnipotent one, right? So in all these regards, what we gather is the identity leads us to our authority, and authority needs to be backed by the power and the spirit of God, which is the purpose why Jesus came, and then also why Jesus resurrected, to display the power and authority over death and over darkness. But then he didn't take it with him, right? He said that I'm going to go up so that way I can send the Holy Spirit down to you, that you will receive power from on high, and then you will become my witnesses. You will become the express light of God by the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Okay, and this is why this is so significant, because God didn't leave us ill-equipped. Okay, but if you guys can gather anything from this message, that there is no deficit. He said he provided every spiritual blessing that we would need. Right, every source of power, every spiritual gift, everything that we need to be effective to overcome darkness, God has given us. Okay, he didn't leave us without. We're not at any form of a lack. The source is plentiful, right? It's abundant. There's no limitation. It's like basically having a military base, but there's unlimited ammunition. Like, you can never run out. In this war, in this battle, in this fight for good versus evil, there's no reason for us to feel at a deficit, to feel at a loss. Jesus already set it up that we're fighting from a place of victory. He already came and defeated the devil for us, right? He left him down here for us to kind of kick him around and to use him as a punching bag once in a while just to test out our strength, right? And what we have to do is own that. And we have to hone that, right? We can't allow the enemy to feel like he has the upper hand, because he doesn't. God already took care of that. But if we live our lives in a manner that is expressive, that the devil still has authority, that the devil still has dominion over us, then what we're doing is we're, in a sense, insulting the cross, right? When we live as defeated Christians, when we don't live as victorious Christians, we're basically saying that what Jesus did on the cross was not good enough. It wasn't sufficient. He wasn't our all-sufficient sacrifice. He, in essence, basically did a halfway job. He only did partial work, and therefore we're left to fight the battle that he didn't complete. Okay, and that's very serious and very significant, because Jesus did more than enough. He overcome the devil, right? He destroyed the works of the devil. And if anything, he's granted us power and authority to have dominion, right? It says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, right? We have the authority, right? He says that we shall trample upon serpents and scorpions and all over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt us or come nigh our dwelling. When he said that, he meant that. Okay, and we have to live in a manner that is expressive of that, not as defeated, not as sickly, not as poor and needy, right? We're not a poor and needy people. We're more than conquerors through Christ who gives us strength. We're seated in the heavenly places where Christ is. We're the head and not the tail. We're above and not beneath. We're more than conquerors. These are not just vain, declarations. This is actual truth that I'm saying, and I'm hoping that it's being received in a manner that is reflective of your acceptance of truth in God by faith. Okay, it's something that you can live out, something that you can express. Okay, so in this regard, like we said, remember, identity, authority, and then the power. Right now, the power is what backs up the authority. Okay, so in this regard, it's kind of like if you could think about like a officer, right, a police officer, right? They got their badge, they have their uniform. You respect the authority when you see them, but people won't feel threatened, or people won't feel as though there's anything to be afraid of, in essence, or to be concerned about if you notice that he's just a flashlight cop. Okay, so if you see a flashlight cop, where's the incentive? Like, where's the fear, you know, in essence, of the power that is supposed to be granted to someone of that level of authority if all they have is a BB gun or a squirt gun, right? But if you see that they actually are armed and dangerous, what it does is that the power adds capacity to the authority. Okay, so therefore, you're gonna watch what you do. You're gonna watch what you say. And kind of what I'm saying is that in the regards of being a Christian, as being a Holy Spirit filled Christian, the devil needs to watch what he says around us. Okay, he needs to watch what he does around us, because the power and the authority that we have as children of light can diminish him, right? Can overtake him. We have the power to overthrow and to cast out demons, right? And to send them back to hell where they came from and things of that nature. So if the devil can't sense, right, he says in the scripture, it says, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? Right? That's an indication of power and authority as it relates to the fear of God over demonic forces, over, you know, the capacity that we have to cast out demons, right? To overthrow the plans of the enemy. And that's why it's so significant for us not to take lightly what God has granted us. We shouldn't be feeling powerless, although that, you know, the enemy has the upper hand on us in any form or fashion of life, because God has given us dominion. Okay, he's given us dominion from the beginning, especially over the animals and everything that relates to this world. And then as believers in Christ, seated in heavenly places, we are seated far above, right? The same way Jesus was seated far above all principality and powers and works of darkness, right? We are seated with Jesus from that place. So if you can look at us as ruling and reigning with him, there's no lack. There's nothing to fear. There's nothing for us to worry. And the Bible says perfect love casts out all fear. So in that regard, once you have the perfect love of God in you, you become fearless, right? The more love you have within you, the more you fear less, okay? And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to develop it to the point where you're fearless. You're not timid. You're bold. You're confident. You know how to be the lion and the lamb as it pertains to how you express yourself, how you display the nature and the characteristics of God, right? Right, in meekness and humility, but also in boldness and confidence and strength. Okay, so this is the first portion, and we're just really trying to establish this. We're trying to hone this understanding, right? So we don't fall back, we don't backslide, we don't think twice about it. We're not easily, you know, swayed back or forth. Okay, so the next portion before we jump into the first song is the reality of actually wearing the full armor of God. Like we said, we're suiting up. We're coming to the comprehension, we're coming to the understanding that in God, we can't just go into battles ill-equipped, we can't go into battles not prepared, and we can't just sit by on the sidelines or just waiting for the enemy to attack us. We have to bring the fight to the enemy. So the first portion is knowing our position of authority, knowing the power we have, and having our identity secured, right? We are children of God. We are of God, little children, right? And greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world. The purpose of that scripture is to make it very clear, very distinct, that God is who he is, right? And God is who he is within us. So therefore, we have the power, the capacity to overcome anything in this world, because what we have inside is greater than what exists outside of us. Okay? Our circumstances, our situations, they're not as great as the God within us. Okay, and that's a mentality shift, right? That's an understanding. That's a rooting. That's a maturity thing. That's a grounding. Right? You're not easily swayed. You're not double-minded. You're not easily knocked down when you comprehend these things, okay? So let's jump into this first song, and it's actually called Ain't Giving Up the Fight, and it's by Monty G, and he's actually talking about knowing this and kind of holding this and not giving up, but realizing who God is and that God is for us. So check this out. This is Ain't Giving Up the Fight by Monty G.
And you almost died. Yes. Deliver us from darkness by your marvelous light. We call on you, and every time you've heard our prayer. See us, see us through, see us through the darkness, lead us to the light. No matter what the evil come with, we ain't giving up the fight. The most I tell me, say them things are for your fear. Time and John here, beg your try, come listen. The trumpet a sound make it
sing. Lead us through the darkness, lead us to the light. No matter what the evil come with, we ain't giving up.
All right. So that was Monty G, Ain't Giving Up the Fight. And that the song is so significant. It's raw. It's pure. You know, it's not as a high tempo song, but it really captures the essence of what we're discussing, right? There's no reason for us to give up the fight when we have God in our corner. There's no reason for us to feel defeated, right? And I know we get there sometimes, and sometimes we do get attacked and we do feel oppressed. And then we do question God and we're like, why? But it really needs to come to the place where we understand who and whose we are so much, like I said, that you just really know what's going on, right? If you get beat up, right, the same thing is like, okay, you got in a fight. Okay, so you go back and, you know, you tell your dad or you tell your father, right? And then he tells you, all right, well, get back up, you know, dust yourself off and go back out there, you know, and own who you are, right? Stand up for what's right. Do the right thing. But don't just come back and like, you know, put your tail between your legs and just give up completely. There's no reason for you to do that. God still wants us to contend against the works of darkness and to overcome them, because greater is he that's in us and he that's in this world. There's no reason for us to lose. We don't have to lose. We could win almost every fight, in essence, if we know how to, and if we are trained and if we're developed in God enough to just realize that we have already won and we can always keep on winning, right? Because greater is God within us and there's no reason for us to lose, right? In essence, so we need to maintain that victorious mentality. We need to maintain this overcomer mentality. So what I want to do now is now kind of branch us into the reality of what are our tools? How do we fight? And how do we take the fight to the enemy? How do we stay on the offensive? And not, we'll be on the defensive as it relates to being attacked or getting an attack sent our way, but we'll be more so on the offensive because we're not timid, we're not fear. The righteous are as bold as a lion, and we go into territory knowing that we have the potential and the power to take it over for the glory of God. In every realm, in every district, right? In every jurisdiction, we're not at a lack. We're not at a deficit. We don't necessarily always need to potentially, you know, ask for permission. In essence, when we know who and whose we are, where we're coming from, what where our agenda is, right? And then how God will honor when we do things properly, when we do things in accordance with his plans, with his regulations, right? There's no reason why we can't take over the kingdom of darkness and express God's light through every area, through every sector, through every dimension of this world. We have the right as children of God that came from the Creator to essentially take over and to overcome every force of wickedness and darkness in every sphere of life. That's the level of authority. That's the level of understanding that we need to comprehend and to operate under, right? When it comes to abortion, right? When it comes to sex trafficking, when it comes to the drug dealing, right? Every aspect that has something to deal with darkness, we have a right to overcome it. And I know in these times it's very complicated and people are trying to mix the truth for a lie and to trying to call good evil and evil good. But there is still one way as it pertains to God. There is still true righteousness. There is still true holiness. And whether it's being distorted, doesn't make a difference. Okay, that's the reality. It doesn't make a difference what the devil tries to call sin nowadays, right? He can change the form of it. He can change the nature of it, right? He can confuse people about what he's doing and then get people confused enough to spread a message of confusion. That's fine. He can do whatever mess he's looking to do, but that doesn't change the distinction and the distinctive aspects of who God says he is, what is right in God, and what his word stands for, and what light is called to do. Okay? So that's how we're addressing this. This is how we're dealing with these facets. That's how we're dealing with these problems. Nothing has changed, right? The pillar and ground of truth is still Jesus, right? He's the Ancient of Days. He is the Rock. He's the Great I Am, right? He's always been the same. He's the same today, yesterday, today, and forever, right? So in all these different regards, God is not changing. He's immovable. He's unshakable. So what we do as children of God, we operate in similar manner, right? We function. We follow suit. Right, we don't change, we don't get shaky, we don't get nervous when this world is falling down and crumbling right before our eyes. That's fine, let it crumble and fall down right before our eyes, but we're here to pick people up, we're here to be the light, we're here to express love and compassion the way Jesus did, and we're not going to be moved. Okay, and that's the reality of who we are and whose we are. That doesn't change with the times, right? We stay consistent, we're steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the truth and in the grace of God, all right? So as it pertains to how do we fight, right, it says in Ephesians 6, 13 through 18, therefore take up the whole armor of God that you might be able to stand in the evil day and having done all to stand firm, right? That's what I just said. Stand therefore having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having the shoes for your feet and having the put on the readiness of the gospel of peace with the shoes of your feet, and in all circumstances taking up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Okay? So that's the battle plan right there. That's the initiation of ownership of being a soldier of God, right? Putting on your armor, knowing how to fight, knowing what your weaponry is, right? And then utilizing it, praying in the Spirit, you know, staying on the offensive, using the word of God, right? The sword of the Spirit, putting up the shield of faith, you know, having yourself secured with truth and being about the mission of the gospel, right? That's your marching orders right there. All that, all of your marching orders right there in Ephesians 6, 13 through 18. That's where it starts right there. Just that knowing, that sense of, oh man, like, I thought I was just a Christian to go on Sunday school. Like, I thought I was just supposed to attend every week, once a week. What does this have to do with armor? What's God talking about fighting the good fight? What is he talking about standing firm? Like, what's going on here, right? Your orientation to God as being a child of God is your enlistment to the army of God, right? And so therefore, you have to be conscious, well-equipped, and endowed by the power of God to comprehend what type of fight am I fighting here? Is it a natural war or is it a spiritual war, right? Do I disagree with something and I go and burn down a building, or I go and punch someone in the face because, yeah, that's the opposite of what God said? No, right? It's the spirit. It's a spiritual war. It's a spiritual dynamic, right? And the other scripture that we're going to discuss later is that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or physical, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, right? And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. So in all these different regards, we have to understand and comprehend that our fight is a spiritual fight. So how do we do this, right? So this is the teaching right now on how to effectively destroy darkness. So as it relates to our defensive mechanisms and our defensive posture, right? This is a strategy. This is a battle plan on how to be effective at destroying darkness, right? On a defensive posture, we use the blood of Jesus. We plead the blood of Jesus over our lives as a defensive mechanism, or like a shield, right? Because the blood of Jesus has power and authority, and the devil can't essentially cross the blood of Jesus or overpower it, because Jesus died as a sinless, spotless lamb, and therefore it has the power of his holiness integrated into it. So when you cover yourself in the blood of Jesus, you're shielded, you're protected by the sacrifice of God, okay? Then also to back that up on a defensive measure is the shield of faith, right? When things come to you and doubt and fear and all these things tell you you can't do and it won't ever be, right? Your shield of faith says, no, in the name of Jesus, I can, I will. And you use that shield of faith, in essence, to contend against the negativity that's sent your way. When darkness comes your way, you push it back with your shield of faith, with the word of God and light. Okay? The helmet of salvation, knowing how you're saved, right? Knowing how God redeemed you is a known fact in faith when you believe the sacrifice, when you understand the cross, right? So in that regard, having the helmet of salvation is knowing that when you give your life to Christ, that you're saved, that you're covered, that you're redeemed. All right, the other aspect is the belt of truth. That's having the comprehension, the knowledge of God, being studied, being well-versed in the Word of God. These are all defensive because when things, in essence, come against you, right, they shield you from it because it's more like you have a something to block you, something to protect you from lies, right? Something to protect you from deception and various forms, okay? Words of affirmation, right? When you encourage yourself in the Lord, when people encourage you as well, can be utilized as a defensive measure against negativity, against darkness, against what the devil has to say, right? Also, defensive is another defensive measure is your character and your integrity, right? When you live in truth, when you walk in truth, what you also get is a safety shield, right? You get protection because you're blameless, right? So that's why you have to have the character and the nature of Christ and essence of your walk too, because that becomes a defensive posture that the devil has nothing to hold on you. He doesn't have a door to enter into your life because you're sinning or you're doing something that's contrary to God's word, right? So take all this in. This is very significant because this can actually ward off and prevent a lot of attacks and actually stop the devil in his tracks and keep him afar off versus him being all up in your business, dealing and meddling and interfering with your life. You want to maintain this level of integrity and character to dispel darkness, to keep darkness out of your life and from the midst of you. Okay, the other side of it is the offensive, right? So the offensive, like we said, in terms of destroying darkness, this is the part that I like, right? Because even as a pastor, what I like is that I don't have to just sit down and take this. I don't have to ever take a beating from the devil, right? You know, there was times when I was growing in God, and I did. You know, I used to have pity parties, and I used to let the enemy, like, depress me and call me names, and I would just accept it because I didn't know how to fight. I didn't know who I was and whose I was. Right, I didn't know how to contend. I didn't know how to fight the good fight of faith. I didn't know how to stand my ground. I didn't know how to push back when the devil came at me. Okay? And what I want you all to know and I want you to experience and to really take hold of is that you don't have to be pushed around in the spirit. You don't have to be depressed and oppressed. You don't have to be possessed even by the devil himself. You don't have to have any form of darkness in your life. All you have to have is the light of Christ. Okay? And how you do that is you use the sword of the spirit. So knowing the word of God, quoting the word of God, declaring what it will be by faith, right, literally puts into the atmosphere or into the spirit like a firm declaration, a firm, substantial essence of God's nature and his truth out there to contend against what is lies, everything that's the deception, everything that is of darkness, okay? So knowing the word of God, declaring it, living it, also holds a lot of weight on an offensive measure against the enemy because he's powerless to a Christian that lives the word, because it becomes inbreathed, it becomes part of your nature, part of your essence, okay? So God's word breathes forth life, and then when you have God's life and you got strength, God's power and authority, you're able to push back darkness and you can kind of attack the enemy yourself. And then also beyond the word of God, in essence, is the spirit of God, which is infused within the word of God. God's word is God breathed, but in terms of the Holy Spirit himself, the person of God, it's a very significant, substantial, and like amazing aspect that God literally embodies us to express himself through us. And therefore, that's almost like the devil. That's almost like God contending with the devil himself in real time. Okay? Through our lives, right? Even though we are in mortal bodies and our flesh, the same way Jesus was here and he did things physically, but through a spiritual dynamic, is the same authority and power he has granted us to express that within a certain measure as we endeavor and as we continually being filled and indwelt and abide in Christ. Okay, so that's very significant. So being filled with the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts, right? That's when we get to be endowed, right? So remember we talked about authority. That's where we gain the power now. Okay, so the power therefore lends to our capacity to affect change in the spirit. So we need to be infilled, we need to be indwelt so we can express that power, we can express that authority in a manifestation sort of way that can actually cause darkness to flee in reality, right? Like actually. So we need to make sure that we are full of the Holy Ghost and power, because that dunamis power is what causes darkness to tremble and to flee and to fear us, because darkness fears light. Okay, if we can understand that and we can express that, it says that the light shined in the darkness and the darkness did not comprehend it. It feared it. It was confused by it. It didn't understand, how could something be greater than me? right? And that's what I'm saying. We're saying greater is he that's in you and he that's in the world. Greater is God in you. Greater is the Spirit of God in all circumstances, in all situations of life. And if you have him within you, there's nothing you can't do, right? There's nothing that can't be overcome. There's no problem. There's no situation that can't be subdued to the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. All right. The other aspect of on the offensive is praise and worship. Okay, so praising God and worshiping is saying and declaring the truth of the reality of who God is and how grand he is, and is letting the devil know, sorry, buddy, you're not it. Okay, so when we maintain that perspective, when we keep our eyes on God, we are actually affirming the reality of God's goodness, his truth, his stature, his authority and power, and we're coming in alignment with the word of God. We're coming in alignment with truth, and therefore we're overcoming the devil because we're not in agreement with him. We're in agreement with God. Okay, the other aspect is declarations of faith, right? Saying, you know, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, right? Saying that, like declaring circumstances that are negative as though they are good, right? It's believing the best. It's knowing that God has all power and authority and that nothing is impossible with him. So in all these regards, we need to own that. We need to maintain that perspective and then walk and declare that, knowing that we have the full authority, we have the full power, and it's a matter of glorifying God, being seated in heavenly places and owning that authority, realizing that we're with Jesus high above all principality and power, and declaring that, right? Expressing that truth. That's the power. That's speaking life. All of that is inclusive of us owning our authority and our identity. Okay, so that's what we need to do. That's how we're going to express. That's how we're going to destroy darkness. And this is the reality of faith, that Jesus is the one that fights our battles, okay? And we have to recognize we're not fighting this alone. There's times when we can rest in God and he can fight the battle himself for us on our behalf. But we have to ask and we have to invite him into the situations, okay? So I want you to check out this next song. This next song is actually related to Jesus being the one who's our defender, right? He's the one that goes before us. He's our rear guard. And there's times that God will empower us to fight a battle, right? But there's times that God will fight our battles, right? When they become too big, when it feels like it's too massive, right? That's when we can call upon God too. But he gives us the place and the power and the authority to also fight battles by his Spirit and power on our own as well with him to all together. Anyway, all right, so check this one out. This is Christopher Gale, and this is Jesus Fights My Battles. Check it out.
Take away from me.
All right. So that's it right there. So that's Jesus Fights My Battles by Christopher Gayle. And that song is a new song. And I just like the way he just delivers it and the way he just kind of indicates to us that God is with us. He fights our battles and nothing to fear. Even if you don't feel like you're the strongest Christian, right? And you feel like, okay, I lose sometimes and I keep on getting it wrong, right? There's no reason to be discouraged. And even if you're not a believer and you happen to be listening to this message, I just want you to understand that Jesus is still fighting your battles, even when you're not aware of it. Right? Like when you don't realize that he's actually fighting for you, he's always going to be with you, right? And he's going to fight your battles until the point where you realize that it's God that was the one that was always protecting you. God was the one that was always keeping you. And eventually, hopefully, you can surrender yourself, give your heart to Jesus, and then come into the understanding of who you actually are, who your real Father is, who your Heavenly Father is, and therefore gain your authority, gain the power, and join the fight. You know, join the winning team. Okay, that's what I like to call us. We're the winning team. Yes, the world has a perception of Christians, and sometimes we don't always get it right. But the reality is that we're still on the winning team, whether you like it or not. And that's just the reality. Once we accept Jesus, once we ask him to forgive us of our sins, we become blood washed and born again saints. And that's the reality of what it is. And that's what Jesus came to die for. That's why he came to this world. That's why he's still listed in history, right? That's why he is one of the greatest, right? Or he is the greatest. Let's just say that. And he is expressed as someone that is in the stature of all the great people of the world, because Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, right? He is the Alpha and the Omega. So in that regard, we have to esteem him and we have to understand who he actually is. Jesus said, "Who do you say I am?" Right? The world will tell you who they believe Jesus is. You have to know who he is, and then you have to learn who you are in relation to him as him being actually God. Okay, and there's a big contention about that all throughout the world and all throughout history, and that's what this fight is all about. This is where good and evil stem from. The reality that God created man, and then man sinned against God and allowed the devil to gain access to our lives and to gain some level of power and authority over us because we were in disobedience. So we're trying to correct that and kind of basically get us back on our feet and to be equipped, to be reconciled onto God, and to be endowed, to be empowered, and then to overcome the enemy and basically bring the fight that he brought to us, right? Because he brought a fight to us, right, in the garden. He brought a fight to us, and he kind of got over on us in the beginning, but then Jesus came and settled the score, and now we get to actually run this world. We get to own it. We get to have our dominion authority, knowing that this is not our permanent place, right? We're just transitioning, but while we're here, we get to be an effective minister of Jesus. We get to be an effective beacon of light. We get to be a representation of hope. We get to be ambassadors of Christ, right? We just get to shine the light of Christ all throughout our lives to express and to empower people, okay, to be better, to come to a better understanding, to come to the revelation of who they actually are in this world, okay? So this is what we're fighting for, and we're trying to get people over to the light side. Right? We're trying to get them over to the bright side. We're trying to get them over the fence in relation to the promised land and to go to heaven and not be deceived, not be dissuaded, not be lied to and oppressed and depressed, and then to come into the fullness of the stature of Christ and to own it, right? And to live it and to breathe it and to express the fullness of all that God has for them. Okay, so the other aspect, and as we start to conclude, right, is that Jesus does fight our battles, but then as we progress, there should be some victories. Okay, there needs to be results. Okay, the way you determine a winning team from a losing team is you look at the scoreboard, right? And in a fight, right, you can say how many knockouts and you can say who's winning or not, right? So in this world, we're called to win. We are winners, right? By the nature of Christ being the triumphant one, the one that overcame death, hell, and the grave, right? So by being on his team, that is the essence of what we're supposed to be about. That is what is supposed to be exude from our life, right? Our lifestyle needs to be that one of victory, okay? And in that regard, we have to be wise as serpents, but as harmless as doves, okay? We have to realize that we have to be sharper. We have to be more anointed. We have to be more full of love than the world. And even Jesus sets a high standard where he says, right, even though like worldly people love themselves and give gifts to each other, what are you doing that's so great, right? How are you being better? How are you being a good representation of me? How are you being a good example of Christ? How are you doing above and beyond what worldly people just do for themselves, right? It's like your heavenly, like your earthly father gave you good gifts. How much more would your heavenly father give you the Holy Spirit so that way you can be a good representation of him all throughout the world? So that's the aspect, right? And in 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 6, it says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not wage war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty thing that raises itself against the knowledge of God. And we take every thought captive to obey Christ, ready to punish every disobedience when our obedience is fulfilled, right? So when we live righteous, we get the rights, in essence, to kind of declare what is right and how people are supposed to live, in essence of fearing God and honoring him, right? That's how we fight back against darkness, right? We live a pure, we live a blameless life. We live a righteous life. We actually know our scriptures and we close the doors to the enemy so that he doesn't have access, right? We need to be blameless in our finances, blameless in our understanding, right? Blameless in our knowledge of God, blameless in the way we do different dealings, right? And how we act and how we speak and how we talk and how we express ourselves, every aspect of who we are in our, like the way we are generous, right? In all these different regards, we need to be blameless because the devil's looking for doors and opportunities to call us out. He's looking for doors and opportunities to say, oh, you're not like Christ in this area. And we know that we're never going to be perfect. And we know that Jesus has already redeemed us. But it's the reality of as we come into the fullness of the stature of Christ, the devil gets less and less power over us because we're becoming more and more like Jesus. Okay, and that's the goal here. And that's how we actually, by staying connected, by staying unified with Christ, right? Resisting the devil, causing him to flee, right? Putting the devil in his place, knowing that we have authority over him, knowing where we stand in relation to the devil and demons, right? Casting them out of people because we believe the truth and we understand and we own the power that he has granted us, right? And then the last part is that when you become a victorious believer, when you become full of the Holy Ghost, when you know your word, when you know your identity, when you know your authority, right? When you utilize the power that he has granted you, you then become into a place where you get to live in essentially in like total dominion and victory and territorial prowess, where there's no place, there's no land that your feet can't touch and bring forth light to that area, right? Or to that atmosphere. Right? So it's literally how Jesus walked around like an orb of light, just bringing goodness to all every vicinity that he ever went, right? Bringing light to every dark place, right? And then, like I said before in the beginning, destroying darkness means being light, right? When you are light, the power of God in you is what is detracting and what is deflecting and causing wickedness to flee and to be extinguished, right? To be vanquished, to be banished, right? And that's what Jesus is coming in the end to actually do in the end, right? He's coming to vanquish darkness, which is the devil himself, and to dispel demons and things of that nature. So in Ephesians 6:12, it says, "For we not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against cosmic powers over this present darkness, against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places." Okay, so that's what we're fighting against right there. And that's what it takes in order for us to overcome, right? We have to realize that we're fighting against principalities and powers and authorities of darkness, against cosmic powers of this present darkness, against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. But when we learn to fight in the spirit, when we allow the spirit of God to flow and move through us, we're defeating darkness, we're pushing back against these cosmic powers, and we're pulling down strongholds and the authority, right? And like we said, as we're starting to wrap up, is in 1 John 4:4, it says, "You are of God, little children, and have overcome them." Right? You have overcome demons. You have overcome oppression. You have overcome all types of forms of wickedness in this world because he who is in you is greater than he who is in this world. So owning that, honing that, right? Walking in that authority is how we get to overtake the devil's kingdom. So what I want to encourage you before we go into the last song is just the understanding and the realization that there is no force, there's no power in this life that is greater than God himself. Okay? And then when you have God within you, there's no situation, there's no circumstance that can overpower, that can overtake you. If anything, because you have the light and because you have the greater one within you, you are able to overcome situations. You are able to declare things. You are able to perform miracles, signs, and wonders and change the circumstance and situations of different dynamics because of who is in you, because of what is in you, right? So having that, having God within you, having the power, being the light, really is what affects change. And that's how we get to destroy darkness. We get to overtake it. We get to overpower it. We get to extinguish it. Okay? So that's how we need to live. That's how we are going to move forward in 2021 and in the future. We're going to realize that by as children of light, we defeat the devil. And we need to get to a place more and more where we are the ones that are oppressing him, where we're the ones that are suppressing the devil, where we're the ones that are distressing the devil until Jesus comes. Okay, that's our authority. That's where we stand. That's what we're about. We're the ones that are essentially going to be oppressing and pushing back and depressing and suppressing darkness and holding it back until Jesus returns and essentially extinguishing it and destroying it because we are children of light. So where light dwells, Darkness Can't Stay. All right, so check out this last song. I'm really grateful for you guys for listening and for always tuning in. And I really pray that you got something out of it and that you really own your authority, your identity in God, and that you just overcome. So this last song is actually called Overcome, and it's by Positive. And I just pray that you guys check it out, soak it in, and just continually walk in your authority, your dominion, and your power, and give God all the glory. In Jesus' name, God bless you.
Never been braver than when I'm in his arms. The Lord is my refuge for the giants and the storms. I hold up my head high. Ain't never met no one that could stop my Jehovah. So let me see the one day who overcome by the blood, yeah. He changed my story. Now I can say, check the records, yeah. I'm a child of the King Most High, so I will overcome. Oh, yeah. So let's go get up, overcome time. Whole place I'm gonna turn up, burn I got time. Can't stop me turning up, overcome, overcome. Whole place I'm gonna turn up. Let me know that we are more than followers. Never forsaken, when I'm in his arms. My provider, yeah, yeah, yeah. There's no ending to his love. I hold up my head high. See, I am not afraid, no. Now your presence is over me. Oh gosh, God make me overcome. So we burn down Satan's kingdom, make it overturned. And the violent taking my force. So we have to take everything that's stolen from us. My love, my peace, my joy, return to me. And every plan that the enemy, it can work again. So let me see the one day who overcome by the blood, yeah. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. We can't be stopped, so let's go.